You ready, Sean?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. 3D printing is an amazing, fun hobby. In fact, it's what powers Matthew's day job. But what about the materials? I know we talk about PLA, we talk about ABS and PVA and nylons and stuff. I haven't really gotten into it much. And so what's great is Matt knows a lot about the materials and he's gonna tell us all about them right here
on 3D Printing Nerd.
Yes. Welcome back. This is Matt from Printed Solid. Hey, Matt.
Hey, Joel.
I have a list of materials here.
Great.
And what's really great is because of your knowledge within the material space, we're gonna get, of this list, three good reasons why someone might choose to use this material. And then using your knowledge and your experience, you're gonna tell us one reason why we would not want to use the material.
Okay.
And let's start with one of the most common materials, PLA. I mean, yeah. I print with that, everybody does.
Right.
What are three good reasons why someone might wanna choose PLA to print with?
Yeah, so there's tons of reasons you'd wanna use PLA, but PLA is very widely available. It's easy to print. You've got lots of good color choices. You can put cool things in it, the fills, the modifications, things like that.
But PLA isn't gonna have structural integrity over time, right? I think that would be a good reason why someone wouldn't want to print with that.
That's probably the biggest problem, yeah. I mean, PLA is great right out of the box, but over time, it will experience a phenomenon called creep. So if a part is loaded over time, it will continue changing shape and it will not be useful long term.
Okay, well, and that's shown right here, right?
Yeah, this is a good example of that. So, you know, you have what was a square shape here, but then this has been clamped for, you know, as a year. And it's still okay, but it's not square anymore. And eventually it's going to get to the point where it cracks.
Okay, that's good to know. So PLA isn't necessarily the best thing for that sort of application, but if you want something pretty, something maybe filled with metals or glitter, that's a decent material to try.
Yeah, and even something that you need to use functionally that is not subject to continuous load.
Okay. Next material though, ABS. I know this is one of the tried and true, one of the first. So what are three reasons why people print with ABS?
Right, so people look at ABS as historically as a structural option. ABS has a good blend of strength and flexibility. So if you bend an ABS part, it's going to give a lot before it breaks. The other really popular use of ABS is easy post-processability. So sanding, vapor polishing, solvent welding, things like that. That is a really great use of ABS.
But also there are some drawbacks. What's one of the reasons why someone wouldn't want to choose to print with ABS?
Yeah, so on ABS, we can go on the negatives forever, but I'm gonna list the number one negative in my opinion for ABS, and that's the styrene fumes.
Okay.
And that it's potentially harmful. So there's lots of other negatives you could list, but I think that's the absolute top of the list as far as why you might not want to use that one.
So it requires more heat than PLA, it requires a heated bed, there is some lifting, it requires a better bed adhesion, but
right.
Because of the VOCs it puts off.
I think that's the biggest problem with ABS. A lot of the other stuff you can work around, you can mitigate, and you can mitigate the VOCs too, but a lot of people don't, and I think that's a problem.
What about PETG? We were talking earlier, and PETG is becoming a more popular material. So what are three reasons why people are choosing PETG to print with?
Yeah, so PETG kind of blends the best of ABS and PLA. The challenges to your environment are not as much as they are with ABS. So you don't want it to be in a freezing cold room, but you don't need it in 80 degree C chamber either.
Okay.
It's also available in a lot of colors now because it is, PETG is more popular than ABS now. So PLA and PETG are the two main materials that people buy. So because of that, prices go down.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of color choices. Now, I would also say with PETG that you can modify it a lot. So we mentioned that with PLA.
Right.
PETG doesn't just mean one thing. It means a lot of different things. So you can have PETG that's good at barely above a warm day temperature, and then you can get PETG that's good up above 120, and they're all just called different things.
Oh, but it's just a base PET with the glycol.
Yeah, different modifiers, different, okay. Science-y things that have been done, but it's all basically, the same stuff.
Okay, well then it seems really positive, but is there a reason why someone wouldn't want to print with PETG?
Yeah, I'd say the worst thing about PETG is it can be kind of boogery.
Boogery?
That's the technical term. Yeah, it's, I mean, this is why...
are you saying like stringy?
No, boogery.
Boogery, okay.
So, you know, that's why E3D came out with those silicone socks a few years back that went right over the nozzle. That was to prevent that PETG from sticking on the nozzle. That's why a number of manufacturers have come out with plated nozzles and things like that.
The brass nozzle, the PETG is sticky and will stick to the brass.
Yeah, and you can also, like, knock it. A lot of times people will print PETG and then knock little boogers again off of the infill, and it'll accumulate on the nozzle. So it's harder for people to get a really pretty print out of PETG versus PLA or even ABS. It's really easy to get a pretty ABS print.
True.
Just not a good ABS print.
Oh, so with PETG, it's something that can be overcome, but that's one of the detractors for choosing it.
Yeah, it does require very careful tuning to get a really pretty PETG.
Okay.
Now for function, it doesn't matter if your part has boogers on it.
Booger parts do function
well. Yes, they do.
Next up is nylons. So I know nylons are a little bit more tough to print with, but what are three reasons why someone would choose to print with a nylon material?
So nylons are generally tough to print with. They are also physically tough as well. So that is, you know, we talk about strength, but strength kind of means different things. And one of the very serious aspects of strength is toughness. So that's resistant to a striking load. So if your part's dropped or being hit with a hammer or, you know, actually being used in something other than just, you know, hanging from it.
Right.
Impact strength becomes very important. So nylon tends to be the king of impact strength in most of the materials that we use. That's going to be your big one. It can be dyed, so you can get lots of different colors with it.
Oh, that's right.
It can also be, one of the kind of negatives about nylon is it tends to not be as stiff, but you can put fillers in it to make up for that stiffness.
And that's where we get like a carbon fiber nylon or a glass-filled nylon. It's going to be a stiffer material, but it's going to maintain that strength of the nylon?
There's a trade-off. So when you put a filler in, you do give up some of the impact strength.
Okay.
But then you also pick up other benefits. Like when you pick carbon fiber in, you improve your UV resistance.
Oh, interesting.
And then you tend to improve the surface finish as well. So this is all about trade-offs.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting though. You get benefit from adding something to the material, but you do lose something from the base material.
Otherwise, we'd all just use one material.
True. That's a good point. Next up are flexible friends of ours, TPU and TPE. Now, TPU is a thermoplastic polyurethane, and TPE is a thermoplastic elastomer. Is a TPE a TPU? Or a TPU a TPE?
A TPU is a TPE. So TPE is kind of a generic bucket that's like kind of like saying plastic, but a little bit more specific.
Wow, okay.
It just means plastics that are flexible, but not rubber.
Oh, okay.
So rubber, you know, it's been vulcanized. You can't remelt it, reuse it again. Whereas a thermoplastic, you can. So it's like a rubbery thing that you can remelt as we do and use it again. But yeah.
So why would someone, what are three good reasons why someone might choose a vulcanized plastic to print with?
So an elastomer, I mean, you would use that to print when you need flexibility or also impact resistance again, but you don't necessarily need structure. So you're gonna go to nylon if you need structure and flexibility with that structure. You're gonna go with a TPU if you just need the flexibility. So got some guys here, these guys. So the guys that I showed you earlier.
That's right.
These
layers a lot.
Yeah, you can get a range of different, like skateboard wheels are typically TPU, and you don't think of skateboard wheels as being bouncy and rubbery, whereas these guys in different TPUs, just different durometers, different hardness.
Okay. You know,
it's easy to kind of flex and bend them.
Well, this one is easier than this one.
Right.
Okay.
But this guy is also a TPU, and you cannot bend him at all. See?
Oh, wow. It doesn't have that hardness of a rigid material, but it feels like a flexible, but it doesn't flex.
Right.
So why is that?
Yeah, so the theory here is that you would be able to have improved impact. Now, we heard that little crack when you squeezed it, so I'm thinking that maybe the way that it was printed was not optimal. So you're losing some of that impact strength. But that's generally, you know, the TPUs, it's gonna be impact, and they're much easier to print than nylons.
Ah.
They're also available in a lot more colors.
Oh, okay. Well, why would someone not choose a flexible material to print with? What's the main reason why that's not chosen?
There's probably two points, I'm sorry.
That's okay,
are worth considering. So everybody knows that NinjaFlex can be a pain in the butt to print.
Yes.
You have to print them slow, you have to modify your extruder, so that tends to turn some people off. But once you're able to use it, assuming that, you know, the equipment modifications isn't an issue, the biggest problem is temperature resistance. So it's basically like PLA.
Oh.
So, you know, the TPUs, you're not going to be able to use them in a hot car. They go from being, you know, flexible to being just droopy and losing their shape the same way PLA does when it's in a hot car.
Okay.
So that's, then you've got to go, they're not going to have the warping, the you know, change of shape that nylon has, but nylon can be used in much warmer environments.
I see.
Yeah.
Well, that's good to know. Now we get into some of the materials that I don't know a lot about, and this one is PC, polycarbonate, right?
Okay.
What are three reasons why someone might choose to print with a PC?
Yep, so PC, so you can see that it's very stiff.
That's got some good rigidity to it. That is quite stiff.
Yeah, it's got you know, good chemical resistance. It's good to high temperatures. You know, PC typically, the blends that we use for printing, like 110, 120, other non-3D printing blends can go much hotter.
Okay.
Also good optical clarity.
Oh, okay. And why, I mean, I'm sure there's a list, but why would someone not try to print with a PC material?
So I'll just hit on this lightly. There's also the same concern as ABS. If you're, so there is some concern with fumes there, but the biggest one is it can be a pain to print with. It can layer separate, do the same kind of things as ABS, but if you have it dialed in, you have a printer that can handle it well, polycarbonate can be pretty good.
So if you have a printer that can print ABS, you have a good chance of having a printer probably capable of printing polycarb?
Maybe. I mean, you do need hotter temperatures. You're gonna need more like 260, 280 versus 250 to 230 for ABS. And your bed is typically gonna need to be 110. ABS is sometimes a little bit less than that.
Okay. We've got marked down PVB, but most of us know that as PolySmooth.
Yes.
So why would someone print with that?
So PolySmooth is a pretty cool material. It's in a lot of ways the same as PLA, not available from as many places, but you know, they have some colors. But the cool thing about that is you can smooth it with isopropyl alcohol, and PolyMaker has made a machine for that.
Right.
So you can have an automated process for making your surface smooth. That's the real benefit of that. I don't need to list three things. It's really one thing.
It's very specific why it exists.
It's very specific.
To be able to smooth prints with isopropyl alcohol and reduce the amount of post-processing time.
Right.
Okay.
So it's smoothing in a safe manner, theoretically,
yes. But why would someone choose? Well, what if someone wanted those characteristics, but we would tell them not to print with a PVB? What would be that reason? Is there any?
So it has the same temperature issues that PLA has.
Okay.
Yeah, so I mean, if you need something hot, you know, you need to use it in your car, and you want to have it smooth, you've got to go back to ABS and acetone.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense. So while the ease of post-processing is taken care of with the isopropyl alcohol's ability to smooth it, we still have the temperature problems that PLA presents, where a hot car will cause it to deform.
Exactly.
Okay.
It can also be really stringy if it's not dry.
Oh.
Another printing challenge.
Boogery?
No, stringy.
Next up, PVA. That's polyvinyl alcohol?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, we know it is glue sticks, right?
Right.
But people can print with it. So what are three reasons why someone would use that with a print?
I mean, we'll say there's two reasons. So the main reason you would use it is a dissolvable support. E3D did this cool thing a couple years back where they used it as a form for wrapping fiberglass, and then they dissolved it out. So that would be another kind of experimental use. But basically, it's still kind of the same thing. It's a dissolvable material. You would use it when you don't want it to stick around.
Okay. And a reason not to use it, I would imagine, I'm gonna take a guess at this one, because PVA is very hygroscopic.
Yep.
And if you don't have the ability to keep the material dry, then printing with it could be a giant pain in the butt.
Yeah, and even when you do, it carbonizes pretty quickly. So if you don't have your temperature management right on your printer, PVA is definitely, even printers that are well tuned for it, even when the material is done well, PVA is not a great material to print with.
Really? Okay, that's good to know. Below that, we've got BVOH. Now, I know BVOH as a dissolvable support, but what is BVOH, and why would someone choose to print with that?
Yeah, so another dissolvable support option. Where it seems to be popular is in the MMU systems and the Mosaic.
Oh,
the Mosaic type system. I don't know if Mosaic's using it right now, but I think they probably could. I think it bonds a little bit better when, I'm not positive about this, because I wonder about this myself, why they use it.
Right.
But I think it does better in these systems where you're changing, you know, rather than having two heads, you have one head and you're putting multiple materials through it. I think it has some benefits there.
So some sort of structural stability, maybe, to be able to go through those sort of systems?
Yeah, it might handle retraction in the MMU better. I'm not entirely sure why it's used pop. That's where it's the MMU is where BVOH is being widely accepted.
So then do you know of a reason why someone would choose not to use it? It sounds like you're not as familiar with the material.
Not. Yeah, okay. So in my experience with using, we have used it. My experience with using it, the stuff that I've used, when you dissolve it, PVA dissolves. It's it's gone. If you have enough water to get the whole thing into solution, it's gone. BVOH doesn't. And you might have comments that say otherwise, but in my experience, I've left it in perfectly virgin, you know, just straight tap water, and just done it over and over again. I'm still left with a stringy blob that I have to pull off myself.
Okay.
So that's good. I might be doing something. Maybe I got bad material. I don't know.
Okay, but that's good to know. One of the reasons why is it in your experience, it just doesn't completely dissolve in water.
Now, it turned into that blob very quickly, within an hour, but then it just stayed there.
Oh. Okay.
So I guess maybe it's like a hydrogel. I don't know. I'm not entirely sure.
More testing is needed.
Yeah.
We're getting close to the end. We've got peak.
Yep.
Polyether ether ketone.
All right.
So there's two ethers in the name.
Yep.
Any reason why?
Yeah, so I'm not entirely sure. I'm sure it has something to peak's not a material that I've used at all. And it's not a material that I've worked with much. But it probably has something to do with the polymer structure, the repeating units.
Oh.
The MERS that turn into polymers.
That's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
So then, because you don't have a lot of experience with it, can you think of three good reasons why someone might use PEEK?
Yeah, I mean, PEEK is a badass engineering material.
Oh,
that's,
okay.
That's it's strong, it's temperature resistant, it's chemical resistant. There are lots of reasons why you would use PEEK.
Oh, okay. So I guess one of the reasons why someone would choose not to is they just don't have a machine capable of printing with it, right?
Yeah, that's a big one. It's also very expensive.
Oh, it is. Okay. Yeah. I guess that would make sense being the engineering material that it is. How expensive, do you know?
I mean, when we see it selling in filaments, it's typically $100 for 100 grams,
that sort of expensive.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, it's like, you know, the ones that...
With PLA being a kilogram for $20 to $30.
Right.
Okay.
It's a serious... You don't make benchies out of PEEK, although E3D did. But
I'm sure they did.
Generally, you're not going to buy PEEK to print benchies.
That makes sense. Well, then, that leads us to Ultim 1010, right? Which is commonly known as PEI.
Yeah.
I know it as bed surfaces,
but
apparently it's a printable filament as well. So what's three reasons why someone might choose Ultim?
So Ultim is, it's like a cheap PEEK. So it's got a lot of the same properties as PEEK, just not quite as good, and it costs a little bit less.
Oh.
That's kind of why you would use Ultim over PEEK.
Okay, well I guess, and then a reason why someone might not choose it would be similar to PEEK as well.
Yeah, it has.
For price and printability.
Yeah, I think it's probably gonna, and you know, again, we're kind of early in the usage of these things, but I think it's going to be easier to use than PEEK. I mean, we see more industrial machines using Ultim than we see using PEEK.
Oh, really?
It could be the cost or it could be the challenge.
Okay. Well, we've got to the end of the list, but I have one more question for
you.
Being someone that knows a lot about materials and 3D printing itself, what does the next, we'll say, what does the next 2 years look like as far as 3D printing materials? Do you think that PLAs will get better, or PETGs could become the king, or will we see a resurgence in ABS, or will we get more awesome engineering materials like PEEK and Ultim?
I think all of those things will
happen. Okay.
I don't see a time coming when PETG takes over PLA. I think PLA will continue to be the hobbyist material, and maybe this will never happen, but until someone says, here's something that's better than PLA for a hobbyist material.
Okay.
Hobbyists want easy.
They want easy and they want cheap.
Right.
And sometimes they can get it on eBay for less than $10 a roll.
Right.
So, okay. But we will start seeing more engineering materials.
Yep.
And if more machines can start to print these materials, then we'll see them slowly proliferate.
Yeah.
Possibly into the hobbyist market, if prices allow. Will we see any advancements in flexibles?
I know people have talked about doing different things where you would have some kind of a structure inside the filament that breaks down that allows it to stay stiff until it's extruded. I've heard people trying things like that, but I mean, that would be an advance, would be something that, you know, you can't push a rope. That's a problem.
You can't push a rope.
So you say, well, it's not going to be a rope until it turns into a rope after being heated. I have no idea what that mechanism would be.
Oh, so
I have heard it discussed.
So it could be that the advancements in flexibles aren't necessarily the properties they get once printed, but the printability.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, there are softer materials being looked at, but that just, you know, now you just have a softer rope.
That's cool. Well, maybe we should revisit this in a year or two.
Yeah.
And reference this video and find out, you know, hey, of these we went through, are some still out there? What are the new stuff? maybe there's different water solubles, maybe PC's easier to print with. Thank you, Matt.
Yeah, thank you.
I really appreciate that. I appreciate you sharing your knowledge with the audience out there. If you have any questions that you think Matt could answer, you can find him at printedsolid.com. Thanks again, one more time.
All right, thank you.
I'll give you one of those. If you like what you saw here, give it a thumbs up. Don't forget to subscribe. Hug each other more. I love you, as always. High five.